I'm going to talk today about PSMA-PET and functional imaging. And it's been an interesting path over the last 8 years. I've been giving talks on PSMA-PET and imaging of prostate cancer. And we've come from, in essence, being fully in the research realm to now being, in essence, standard of care. Someone had a quote the other day that I really liked, which was that prostate cancer has gone from being one of the worst imaged cancers to now the best imaged cancer, which has really changed the way we've thought about treatment, right? Before you didn't know where disease was, but now that you do, you can start doing more things like metastasis-directed therapies, I'm sure will be talked about at this conference. So let me get started. Now, we're going to talk obviously about the prostate-specific membrane antigen. It's a protein that's expressed on the surface of prostate cancer cells. Now, interestingly enough, it's actually not prostate-specific. It's also expressed on multiple benign lesions and also other cancers. But in the setting of someone who has prostate cancer and has at risk for metastases, the presence of expression of PSMA really does suggest that that lesion is prostate cancer. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we move along. Now, this all started for me back in the day with gallium PSMA 11, right? And this is the molecule that we use to image prostate cancer. And on one end of the molecule is a chelator, right? This is called HBED CC, doesn't really matter, but it binds to the radioactive material, the radiometal, or in this case, the gallium 68. On the other side of the molecule is what we call the urea motif. This is the targeting molecule. It's what binds to PSMA or binds to the prostate cancer cells and carries that radioactivity into the tumor. So we put gallium 68 into that chelator, and then we take this molecule and we put it in a syringe and we inject it into patients. We wait an hour and we image that patient in a PET CT and we create images like this, which will show us in this case where the metastatic disease is or where the prostate cancer is in this patient in the right femur. Now, the thing that you have to keep in mind is that prostate cancer is very different across different patients. Some patients have no evidence of disease. Actually, obviously, the vast majority of patients have no evidence of disease. And then some patients have low volume, focal, diffuse, different levels of uptake, and it's very heterogeneous across patients. And sometimes it's hard for an individual patient to understand this because for us, we see so many different patients across this disease spectrum. It's important to keep in mind this variability. Now, this is really important, for example, in a patient like this. And I love this case, and I've been showing it for years, right? This is a patient who underwent a radical prostatectomy, right? He had his prostate taken out, and his PSA started to rise. Now, in this case, the PSA was 0.67. Now, when this was back in the patient, we were imaging him, and maybe in 2016, 2017, a PSA of 0.7 was really low, right? And so we imaged him, and we saw two sites of disease, one in the right humerus and a left internal iliac lymph node. Now, this is very different from where we would have thought his disease was had we not had a PSMA PET. This patient would have undergone salvage radiotherapy to his prostate bed, maybe his pelvic lymph nodes, and we wouldn't have treated his disease, and his PSA would have continued to rise after he completed his course of androgen deprivation therapy. But now that we know where his disease is, we can treat it with oligometastatic treatment, SBRT radiation therapy to the humerus, to the lymph nodes, and maybe also the prostate bed, and that hopefully will change the course of his disease. What I like about this image, though, is that in order to image this patient back in the day years ago, you would have had to have gotten a bone scan and a CT scan all the time, bone scans and CT scans, because the only way to image metastatic disease in the bones is with a bone scan, and it's not very accurate. And in order to see lymph nodes, you need a CT scan. But even in this case, that lymph node is really too small to be really sure that it's metastatic disease. So now we've combined those together into a single imaging study, PSMA PET. And it's great now moving forward, patients are being imaged with PSMA PETs rather than bone scans and CTs. Now, there's a number of studies out there that have studied PSMA-PET, and you'll see here there's actually three different agents that are being used: gallium PSMA-11, DCF-PYL, or piflufolastat or Pylarify, and then also RH-PSMA-7. That's the newest one on the block that was approved sort of the middle of last year. What's interesting in general is the sensitivities are pretty similar across each one of these. And remember, this sensitivity here is for detecting of pelvic lymph nodes prior to radical prostatectomy. It's a very hard circumstance to find disease. And usually the lesions you're missing, the lymph nodes you're missing, are really only a millimeter, 2 millimeters, 3 millimeters in size. Okay. Now, there's also trials in the biochemical recurrence setting. Right. And so, again, these are also in the DCF-PYL PSMA-11 setting. And the main point here is as the PSA falls, the detection rate goes down. Right. So when you have a lower PSA, there's a lower volume of disease. In that setting of a lower volume disease, it's harder to localize the sites of disease. Now, back in 2020, that's when we got approval for PSMA-11 at UCSF, and it was approved for patients at initial staging who are candidates for either a radical prostatectomy or radiation therapy, or patients at biochemical recurrence whose PSA was rising after definitive therapy, radical prostatectomy or radiation therapy. Now, since then, as you can see here, there's a whole number of other agents. So DCF-PYL was approved in 2021. RH-PSMA-7 was approved in 2023. PSMA-1007 is currently undergoing trials. And then in the bottom right there, PSMA-617 is being studied for, or actually not studied, but FDA approved in 2022 for treatment of late stage castration resistant prostate cancer. As you'll notice here, these all share the same urea motif. So they, in essence, have the same targeting molecule that targets the PSMA molecule. And sort of, I think of them as a class that we're using interchangeably to image patients with prostate cancer. I think this paper back in 2019 out of our radiation oncology department was really important. And it showed that in patients with high-risk cancer at initial staging, when they were undergoing definitive radiation therapy planning, the PSMA-PET changed the plans in over half of patients. Right. So even though it wasn't really saying you weren't going to do RT or you were going to do RT, if you're doing RT, it actually tells you where the sites of disease are better. So you can boost the pelvic lymph nodes or also include disease outside of the standard consensus tumor volume, really highlighting how important PSMA-PET is in patient management. Now, additionally, as you get higher PSAs in the setting of biochemical recurrence, right? So this is in the setting of biochemical recurrence after definitive therapy. Also out of our radiation oncology group, you can see as your PSA goes up, we see disease in more and more patients. But most importantly, in patients with a PSA less than 2 after radical prostatectomy, 30% of those patients had a disease that was missed with standard radiation therapy, right? Really highlighting we're missing disease because we can't see it. And if you look in the literature at the rate of patients who have biochemical recurrence after salvage radiation therapy, it's about 30%, right? And we're recurring because we were never treating the entirety of the disease. And obviously this is no longer the case because we're using PSMA-PET routinely to stage these patients prior to radiation therapy. There's also data showing significant changes in management. Obviously, if you have no evidence of disease, more people are going to go towards surveillance. If you have local disease, we have more local treatment. And if you have metastatic disease, you're more likely to have a change in management towards metastatic disease, which is prior systemic therapy, pretty straightforward. I think this patient, though, is really what highlights the importance of management change, right? So this is a patient who comes in a PSA of 24, Gleason 4+3, so high-risk prostate cancer based on that PSA. And you can see in the prostate bed, there's focal uptake, but this patient also has disease in the mediastinum and also up in the neck, right? What we call the supraclavicular region. Now, back when this study was done years ago, this wasn't believed, so it was biopsied and shown to be prostate cancer. And you can see how this would completely change the way this patient was treated. Originally, this patient would have undergone a radical prostatectomy. We wouldn't have known where the disease was. He would have biochemically recurred or had biochemical persistence, et cetera. And instead, now we know where the disease is, and so we can tailor the patient's treatment to understanding and treating where the patient's disease is. Now, one thing I want to talk about here, and this is really important, is this idea of false positives, right? And remember, in the very beginning, I mentioned that PSMA-PET is not specific to prostate cancer. And there's a number of types of lesions that can have uptake on a PSMA-PET. And particularly these rib lesions are the things that cause the most problem, right? And so if you have someone at initial stage and you have a single lesion in the rib, it's nearly 98% chance that it's benign. Not that it's actually cancer. And you can see in this lesion, you have this sort of sclerotic rim, has a characteristic appearance that would be an aneurysmal bone cyst rather than metastatic prostate cancer, but it has pretty good uptake on the PSMA PET. And there's a lot of importance about reader training and understanding what is or is not real disease. And I think this is really important because the last thing I want to have happen is a patient to be withheld from receiving definitive therapy, surgery like radical prostatectomy or radiation therapy, when a PET scan is misleading and shows metastatic disease, when in fact there actually is not metastatic disease. Here's an example of a presacral ganglia. When I was just starting doing PSMA PETs, I'm sure I called that metastatic disease. But now that we know these things are benign, we're no longer thinking of them as false positives. And I actually think of them with good reader training, we're converting them to true negatives. And I think, you know, we always think about these false positives on PSMA PET, but actually we forget that back in the day with bone scans were even worse, right? If you look at patients who were called metastatic using a bone scan, okay, at initial staging, so you got diagnosed with prostate cancer, you get a bone scan, you get a CT scan, and that bone scan was called positive for metastases, only 43% of those patients actually had metastatic disease, okay? So bone scans were even worse in terms of false positives, and it's sort of disturbing to think about how we were probably mismanaging patients years ago, a decade ago, because we didn't have accurate enough imaging. And so here's an example of a patient who had a nodal disease, right? You can see the black arrow in the middle panel there under A, and that's a lymph node that was missed on a CT scan and obviously not seen on the bone scan, but the bone scan called multiple different lesions and was called metastatic disease on bone scan, but on the PSMA PET, you can see there was actually no disease in any of the osseous lesions or the bone lesions. So, you know, even though I am mentioning all the false positives on a PSMA PET, it's actually still markedly improved compared to the previous conventional imaging. And it's just important to note, when you have low volume disease, particularly before you're deciding on your initial therapy, surgery, or radiation therapy, make sure to think about whether or not that could be a false positive. Okay, so my last section here is going to be about what's the future of PSMA PET. Okay, so the first thing we're going to talk about is, should we use PSMA PET to detect clinically significant cancer in the prostate, right? We know it looks for metastatic disease, but wait, shouldn't we be thinking about using this in place of MRI? And so we've actually developed this thing called a primary score, which is a way to say whether or not the uptake on the PSMA PET is consistent with prostate cancer. So there's now a grading schema to characterize disease in the prostate prior to any therapy. And I didn't run this trial. In Australia, they ran this trial called the primary trial, where they showed that PSMA PET was actually pretty similar and actually improved to MRI just a little bit in terms of the detection of disease in the prostate. And there's now something called a primary 2 trial that's about halfway done with enrollment in Australia, where they're trying to evaluate in men with indeterminate lesions on MR. So you get the MRI first. If you have an indeterminate lesion, a PI-RADS 2 or 3, then you get a PSMA PET. And the idea here is that you can prevent patients from getting unnecessary biopsies based on the MRI if you have a stone cold negative PSMA PET. And that's actually really helpful. So you're using the PSMA PET to actually troubleshoot hard MRI reads in patients prior to diagnosis. This is obviously not yet clinical in the United States, but I think it's an interesting role for PSMA PET. Then another question that comes up is, how often should a PSMA PET be performed, or should it be replacing a bone scan? So you can think about, right now, you get a PSMA PET at initial diagnosis. maybe a biochemical recurrence, maybe somewhere later on when you have metastatic or non-metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancer, and then maybe when you're thinking about treating someone with PSMA radioligand therapy. But this is over, in many patients, 10 to 15 years. Where else or should we be using PSMA PET over time? And how do we think about CT and bone scans being interplayed with these PSMA PETs? And this is obviously not yet decided. We don't know how to do this, but it's a really interesting question. So currently, we use it, right, at initial staging, at biochemical recurrence, at time of subsequent progression, in the absence of metastases. So if we don't yet have metastases, we are getting a PSMA PET. And, you know, the question is, do we need a CT and bone scan to know that you don't have metastases? How do we make this decision? We don't really have a good workflow for this. And then obviously we also use it in patients for selection of PSMA radioligand therapy. But there still is a role for conventional imaging. And this is particularly later in the stage of disease. As patients develop or progress to castration-resistant patients, we are more likely to have PSMA-negative disease, particularly in the liver. And that's where we would require a CT with contrast. But whether or not we need to have bone scans, it's sort of unclear. And earlier on in the stage of disease, it's not clear at all that you need a CT with contrast and bone scans. So as we go on later, we do need CTs. And I think this is a really unknown question that needs to be answered. The last thing here is we need to understand better how to manage patients and when metastasis-directed therapy should be used. And so here's an example of a patient from many years ago who had two pelvic lymph nodes. His PSA was rising, it was below one. We did SBRT to those two lymph nodes, and he's now been with a PSA of zero for maybe 5-6 years since treatment of these oligometastases. Now, these are anecdotes. They're certainly not the rule, but at the same time, we need to think about what's the best way to use radiation therapy, metastasis-directed therapy, to manage these patients. And there's trials like this, the STOMP trial, which showed that patients who got treated with metastasis-directed therapy had later use of androgen deprivation therapy compared to surveillance. So that's sort of suggestive. This wasn't with PSMA PET. Then there was this trial, the Empire One trial, comparing fluciclovine to conventional imaging, showing that when you use fluciclovine for planning your radiation therapy, patients did better. And then there's this trial out of UCLA where they use PSMA PET, sort of like the last trial, to see whether or not we can show improved outcomes with PSMA PET compared to patients imaged with conventional imaging. And this is getting close to reading out, so I'll be excited to see this. But this is sort of where the field's moving forward. And there's many, many other trials trying to understand the role of PSMA PET moving forward. So in summary, there's now 6 approved NDAs for PSMA PET, which is pretty incredible. DCF-PYL, RH-PSMA-7, and 4 for gallium-68 PSMA-11. PSMA PET impacts management in over 50% of men with biochemical recurrence, and it really has its primary impact on planning for radiation therapy. And lastly, there's a lot to come. What's interesting is the future is not about developing new imaging agents anymore. It's about how do we use these imaging agents best to manage and help improve the outcomes of men with prostate cancer. So I'd like to thank a whole host of people who've helped a ton over the years at UCSF to make all of this happen. And then maybe most importantly, you, the patient. Really, it's patients being involved in clinical trials, engaging in this, and really helping make this successful as we move forward. So thank you all for being willing to participate in all of our clinical trials, because it really does change and move the needle to help improve outcomes. So thank you very much also to my funders, and I hope the conference is a great success and you learn a lot.